So our first speaker. We have another slacker. All that Paula Arlotta does is chair the Department of Stem Cell and Regenerative Biology at a modest university up the river called Harvard. If you come visit her lab, you'll find things that you're likely to see every day, like brains growing in dishes. Surely you have several of these at home. This is the research that enables all of us to understand the molecular laws that govern the birth, differentiation, and assembly of the human brain's cerebral cortex. Please welcome Paula.
Okay. Well, thank you so much for having me here today. So every day we sort of do this. We talk to each other, we have conversations, we feel, we think. What we don't do is to think much about the organs that sits between our ears. Let's see if this starts. Oops, sorry. Oh. Yes. The organ that sits up between our ears, the human brain, that really allows us to do these wonderful things. And so someplace in here are the billions of cells, the billions of connections, the electrical pulses that makes us. Our thoughts, our personality, our feelings is all in here. And so perhaps it's not surprising that for as long as we can remember, humankind has been obsessed with this idea of understanding how the human brain works and also how the human brain is made. And you say, why is that? Why can't we know how the human brain is made and how it works? Well, it doesn't take a neuroscientist to look at the brains of two species, a mouse here, which is the typical animal model that we use to understand development of the brain and function of the brain, and the human brain. In this case, this is my son, who clearly did not want to be photographed. It doesn't take a neuroscientist to see that these two brains are very different. They're not only different, they develop differently. And there are cells and parts of the human brain that are not even present in a mouse brain. So if we want to understand how the human brain is made, we kind of have to look at the human brain as a model system. And here is the problem, that the majority of development of the brain, in fact, does not happen once we're born. It happens in utero when we develop in the wombs of our mothers. So this is a tissue and a process that we will never, therefore, be able to look at, experiment with, and really understand. So should we give up sort of this aspiration for understanding how our own brain develops and works? Is this sort of an overly academic exercise that we like to do at university of really understanding where the brain comes from? So I think that to a certain extent, yes, it's fascinating. We all want to understand this process, but there is also something else. So understanding the human brain is not only a basic fundamental question. This relates to then understanding what goes wrong when the human brain is not made correctly or when it doesn't function correctly. And so if I ask any one of you in this room whether you know someone or you're connected with someone with some of these diseases, autism, depression, schizophrenia, bipolar disorder, these are some of the most devastating diseases of our time, really. The likelihood is that many of you, actually most of you, will really raise your hand. So we don't understand really these diseases because we don't understand really how the brain is made and how it works. And therefore, we don't treat them, we don't cure them at the moment. We know more. We now have the first genetic picture of what is behind genetically these diseases. And what this picture is, and by that I mean scientists have sequenced the DNA of many, many patients and many control individuals. And what this picture really tells us is that these are not simple diseases. These are not diseases associated with mutations in one gene, one code of DNA in the genome. These are diseases of the whole genome, where many, many components within the genome contribute as small amount to the likelihood of developing the disease. And so if you think about a disease that fundamentally originates in the totality of the human genome, that the only way you have to study what this genetic does to the brain is to use the human genome and a human model. And so this brings us back to the fact that we need to study the human brain. If we can't access the development of the human brain, but we need to understand it, what can we then do? And I say, how about we make the human brain? I'm gonna let that settle for a moment. We make the human brain. If you think about all of the most difficult things that humanity has done, has it been, I don't know, the tallest skyscraper, a quantum computer, what has it been? If you think about it, everything pales compared to this. Can we make the human brain, some of the most complex really tissues that we have? And I think this is a valid question because ultimately, if we could imagine, if we could make a tiny little primitive replica of the beautiful process of brain development, human brain development, starting from another cell of our body, then we could have a model, an experimental model, a tissue that we can study, manipulate, investigate, molecularly probe to begin to understand, as I show on the left here, how the human brain is made, but also to begin to understand what is wrong in the brain of a kid with autism, for example, that develops a pathology. We could understand what that complex genetics really does to the development of the brain. And ultimately, we may even have a cellular platform where the drug screening for this disease occurs on the very tissue of the very patient that you're trying to understand. Sort of a miraculous kind of thing, right? So let's make the human brain. Let's think about what it takes to make the human brain. We know what takes nature to build the human brain. It takes basically the entirety of gestation. All the 9 months are spent making the building blocks, the cells of the brain. And you say, my goodness, 9 months to make the brain. But we all know that that makes a baby brain. This is my daughter now. So a baby brain, and then what does it take? It takes 20 years or so of experience dependent, living, learning, experiencing to shape that baby brain into the brain of a kid, and watch this, into a brain of a teenager. Now, I don't know how many of you in this room are parents of teenagers, I clearly am, and you know that even by 15 years, that brain is not finished. It will be in a few years, gives us all hope, but it's not done. So it's a complex process. Millions of years of evolution to generate this crown jewel of tissue that we have that allows us to do what we do today. And so it's a bit ambitious to think that we might be able to at least model a tiny little primitive version of this beauty starting from stem cells in a dish. I myself have wondered if any of this might be possible, but I can tell you that what I'm holding here, and I'm gonna pass it along, are actually tiny, perhaps insignificant looking, the size of a tiny raisin, samples of human brain tissue. Except this was not made in an embryo in utero, this was made in my lab, starting from stem cells. I'm just gonna pass this along and you guys can take a look. It's nice and clean, don't worry. okay, so perhaps this is possible. In fact, today, what we can do is to take a sample of blood or skin from any one of us. We can turn that blood into a stem cell, and then take that stem cell and with specific culture conditions in the dish that mimic some of the signals that the embryo gives to the brain to be made, one can make hundreds of these human brain organoids that you are looking at in that vial. You can look inside these brain organoids, and what you see here in the different colors are the cells that constitute the brain. And if you look at the single cell level, these cells actually look quite good, quite similar to what you see in vivo. However, it's very, very important to remember that saying brain is not the same as saying brain organoid. It's a replica. It's a primitive replica of the brain. It will always be a primitive replica of the brain, but perhaps it's got enough information in it to allow us to study for the very first time this process of formation of the brain and what goes wrong in the context of a neuropsychiatric illness. So I think that we need to begin to imagine a future here We need to begin to imagine a future where we might be able to study this process that we have never been able to study before. Now, as a society, we need to also come to terms with sort of the ethical framework of this work. How far should this be? How far is enough for understanding what we want to do? I think as scientists, we also have the responsibility, though, to begin to consider what this can allow us to do for understanding this very complex and, frankly, never understood diseases of our society. We have an opportunity to use the systems now to gain more knowledge and potentially develop different treatments. Should we go for it, or should we not go for it? And I'll stop here by saying that the work is in progress, of course. Every day is a progress. But perhaps if we think about one thing and one thing only is the fact that these little, perhaps insignificant samples of human brain tissue that we can watch develop in a laboratory will help us get there, perhaps get to a cure one day. Thank you.